Hello everyone, welcome to today's lecture. This is lecture number 5 for the module 1, and today we'll be discussing about the concept of the learning and the general to specific ordering, that is the concept learning and the general to specific ordering. Before that, let us quickly have a recap of our previous lecture, what we discussed in our previous lectures. Right, so we discussed about well-posed learning problems. What are the different types of problems which can be posed as a well-posed for a machine learning, from a machine learning perspective? So we had a problem with respect to automated car, can be called as a well-posed problem. Then the checkers game, the backgammon game, right, and other examples also, right? So and the handwriting system, and then the speech recognition, and so on. So there are many problems that we discussed, well posed problems, which can be termed as a learning problems from a machine learning point of view. Then we also discussed about designing that particular learning problem, learning system. We took an example of checkers game, and we designed a learning system by selecting the training experience, the target functions, how to choose a representation for that target function, then also the choosing of a function approximation algorithm. We discussed about LMS algorithm, that is least mean square algorithm, and the final design. If you remember in our previous lecture, we saw a summary of the final design of this particular checkers game, designing and learning system, learning system for the checkers game. And we also discussed about perspectives and issues in machine learning, right? So we discussed a few issues, like what can be, what algorithm can exist for learning a specific target function, then what algorithm performs best for what type of problems, and what is the best way to reduce the learning tasks to one or more than one functions, approximation problems, and so on, right? So, and whether these things can be automated or not. So that's what we discussed in our previous lectures, right? So moving ahead today's point of discussion will be the concept learning and the general to specific ordering, right? So we'll look upon the concept learning task along with the introduction part. The concept learning as such, maybe we can cover in the coming lectures, but under this title we'll be learning these concepts, like the introduction of the concept learning task, the concept learning as a search, that is general to specific ordering of hypotheses, then findus algorithm, that is finding a maximally specific hypothesis. We'll also be learning about what is a version space and the candidate elimination algorithm, and ultimately at the end of this chapter we'll be learning about the inductive bias. So this lecture will be more focusing on the concept learning task along with what is the introduction for that concept learning task, right? So let us start with today's lecture. So we'll start with the introduction of the concept learning. We will see what is concept learning and the concept learning task, the notations, its representation, and the inductive learning hypothesis, right? So talking about the concept learning. Now, see, we all know that learning involves, you know, acquiring general concepts from specific training, general concepts from specific training examples, right? So people, for example, you know, continually learn, any people, they continuously learn general concepts from specific training examples. Now, specific training examples or general concepts or categories, right? Categories such as, let's say, a bird, right? Or category for a car, let's say we have object car. So each such concept, there can be many different concepts, right? These are just two examples. So each such concepts can view as describing some subset, you know, describing some subset of objects. For example, you know, let's say bird itself. So these concepts can be viewed as describing some subset of the objects or events defined over a larger set. Now this, for example, the subset of animal, the subset of animals that constitute birds, right? That can be, you can say, the subset of objects for events defined over a larger set. So, for example, defining some features like, let's say, two legs, feathers, a beak, can be few features which can be extracted and can be categorized and can be applied on a larger set, right? So similarly, in this situation, maybe features like wheels, we have four wheels, a windshield or a headlamp, right? So those can be categorized to identify, can be applied for on the larger set, right? So these can be a subset. Now, each concept can be thought of as a Boolean value, right? Each concept we have, it can be thought as a Boolean value. Boolean value we have, I think you all be aware with the Boolean values, right? Zeros and ones, binaries, then true and false. Boolean is, that is, we have only two values that can be either true or a false. So when we have an object which can be classified into two types, that is, either it can be true or false, it can be called as a Boolean value function. So the concept can be thought as a Boolean value function defined over this larger set. Example, like a function defined over all animals whose value is true. All animals whose value is, let me come back to the slide. The function defining over all animals whose value is true for birds. Let's say this is just an example. Let's say it is true for birds. And let's say if it is true for birds, we can say that it is defined over all animals. If it is false, then it is false for all other animals. This is just a Boolean value. So this complete problem of automatically inferring the general definitions, right? The automatically inferring to the general definition of some concepts. Automatically inferring the general definitions of these concepts can be labeled as members, right? Either labeled as members or non-members. Either they fall into the category of, let's say, birds, or either they don't fall into the category of birds. So either they can be members or non-members of the underlying concept. So this task is commonly referred to as the concept learning, right? So concept learning or approximating a Boolean valued function, right? A Boolean valued function from some examples. Now, what is this concept learning? Again, if we want to put it into a proper definition, concept learning can be called as it can be termed as inferring a Boolean valued function from training examples of its input and output, right? So inferring a Boolean valued function from training examples of its input and output. I would request you to take a note of it. So let's take an example wherein let's say we have a friend Aldo, and we are supposed to help to him. The task here is to learn the target concept, that is the days on which, let's say, my friend Aldo enjoys his favorite water sport, right? So let's say we have an example here to learn the concept wherein we are going to help the Aldo. We are going to help him to learn, that is, days on which Aldo enjoys his favorite water sports. We are going to help him to identify on which day he has to enjoy a sport or not to enjoy, right? So main attribute here is the enjoy sport. Let's say let me show you the table. Let's say we have this table wherein we have some positive as well as some negative training examples for the enjoy sport are targeted concept, right? So we have few examples here, and ultimately we are looking for the attribute whether Aldo can enjoy the sport, yes or no. The ultimate answer would be it is yes or no, right? So let us split this example, divide this and understand how it is. So the question that we need to ask here is, what hypothesis representation shall we provide to the learner, right? What hypothesis representation shall we provide to the learner in this case? So let's say we have different types of hypothesis representation. We have many possible representations. Let's say we have edge, which is a conjunction of constraints on attributes, right? It is just a conjunction of constraints. We have set of constraints depending on a few factors. Let's say we have, let me go back to the, this table. That is, we have few attributes like sky, air temperature, humidity, wind, water, forecast, and so on. We'll discuss this thing, right? So these are the constraints, right? So H is conjunction of constraints on attributes. Now, what are these attributes? We'll learn this thing. Let's say each constraint can be a specific value, like water has to be warm, right? Or don't care condition, like for example, water can be anything. So question mark represent here, it is don't care, or we are not bothered about the value, whichever value that we get here in the hypothesis. And no value allowed, that is no value allowed can be represented using example, water is equal to this symbol. This symbol will represent that no value is allowed. So let's say, for example, we have an hypothesis. This is an hypothesis, we can say. Let's say this is a high. Okay. So this is a hypothesis. Sunny, question mark, strong, then question mark, and then again same. So sky, sunny, air temperature, we are not bothered, don't care. Humid, we don't care. Wind should be strong, and water, we don't care again. And forecast should be same as suggested. So this is just an example of an hypothesis. Definitely this can vary for depending on the playing conditions. Fine. So here we have the six attributes. We have the six attributes to enjoy the sport, the attribute for the enjoy sport. Let's say we have sky, the attribute of sky. We have air temperature. We have humidity, wind, water, forecast, right? So for each of these attributes, hypothesis will either be indicated by a question mark, like I mentioned, which is we don't care about it, that is that any value is accepted for this particular attribute, or else the hypothesis will either be specifying a single required value, example that we discussed, like water should be warm for the attribute water, right? Or the hypothesis will either be indicated by this symbol. This symbol will represent that no value is accepted, right? It shouldn't have any value for that particular attribute. So these are the parameters we need to take care while defining a hypothesis, right? So let's say if some instance is X, right? Let's say some instances X satisfy all the constraints of hypothesis H, then that hypothesis H classifies instance X as a positive example, and that is represented as H of X is equal to 1, right? So this will be represented as H of X is equal to 1. Now, just to give you, just to illustrate that the hypothesis that Aldo enjoys his favorite water sport, let's say only on the cold days, only on the air temperature, with the air temperature is cold, right? This is just an example, which which can be, this is just to represent how an hypothesis can be represented, right? So let's say we have air temperature cold and humidity as high. Let's say Aldo wants to enjoy only on that day. So that is independent of the values of other attributes. So we are only focusing on air temperature and humidity. So in that case, this is just an hypothetical case, maybe. This might not be ideal conditions to play, but in case, let's say we have air temperature cold and humidity as high, and other attributes we are not worried about them. It is independent of the values of the other attributes, right? So in that case, the hypothesis can be represented as this particular expression, right? Where the attribute sky is don't care, the air temperature is cold, humidity is high, wind we don't care, water we don't care, and forecast we don't care. So this is actually not an ideal condition. Very bad example, you can say. Very bad condition to play the water sport. So moving right, so this is the table which gives us the positive and negative training examples for the target concept for the enjoying the game, right? So you can see here, like sky, when the sky is sunny, air temperature is warm, humidity is normal, wind is strong, water is normal, forecast remains same, then let's say we should enjoy the Aldo should go to enjoy the water sport. So this is our one hypothesis. Similarly, when the sky is sunny, air temperature is warm, let's say it's warm, humidity is high, wind is strong, water is warm, and forecast is same, let's say same. So it is yes. If it is, the sky is rainy, right? So if it is rainy, air temperature is cold, humidity is very high, wind is strong, water is warm, forecast is changing, right? Forecast is change. Then we don't suggest Aldo to enjoy the water sport, right? And again, another example of positive example, third one is the negative example, right? Positive example, another can be, let's say sky is sunny, so it's open, air temperature is warm, humidity is high, which is fine, wind is strong, water is cool, forecast is changing, and still we can say that Aldo can still enjoy his water sport, right? So this is just an example. Now, the most general hypothesis, as you could have pointed out or maybe visualized by this time, that the most general hypothesis, which can be termed as a positive, is represented like this. So it can be represented like this, wherein we can see that all the attributes, all the six attributes here, are don't care conditions, right? So we are not specific to any thing that this particular attribute has to have this particular value. We are keeping it acceptable for all the values, keeping it don't care condition, right? And opposite to it, the most specific possible hypothesis, that is no day is a positive example, no day is a positive example, then that can be represented as all to be null values, right? So this symbol, what this symbol indicates is that it should no value will be accepted for this particular attribute. So when all the attributes have this symbol, we can say it is, most specific. Now here is the difference, right? Most general hypothesis, and this is most specific hypothesis, right? So this is the most general hypothesis, and this is the most specific hypothesis representation. So coming up to the notation, now, the set of items over which the concept is defined can be called as an instances. We have set of instances, right, which can be denoted as X. Now these instances X are the set of items over which the concept is defined. The concept is defined, right, with the set of items. Now the possible days that each described by the attributes can be sky or air temperature, humidity, wind, water, forecast, that is what we discussed in the previous slides, right? And the target function can be, let's say target function C, small c, is enjoying the sport right? Which enjoying the sport, having x is nothing but our instance. Let's say we have instance, which can be a boolean value, a 0 or a 1. Either we can enjoy the sport, yes, or we cannot enjoy the sport, no, right? So 0 or 1. So hypothesis, let's say H, we can say the set of hypotheses, a conjunction of literals. Example is what we discussed in the previous slide. And let's say we have training examples D, where D is actually denotes the set of available training examples. D is the symbol which is used to denote the set of available training examples. So training examples set D can have positive and negative examples of the target function. So here is how it can be denoted: x1, cx1, and so on to xm, cxm. Right? So what we have to determine here is what is the main aim, right? So before that, let us discuss in detail, like sky and temperature, humidity, all these things we studied in the previous slide, like in the table, right? Sky can be either, it can be sunny, it can be cloudy, it can be rainy. Air temperature can be warm or cold. Humidity can be again normal or high. Wind can be you can say strong or weak. Water can be warm or cool, and the forecast can be with the values same or change, right? So these can be the values for these six attributes. Sky can have the value sunny, cloud, rainy. Air temperature can have the value warm or cold. Humidity can have the value normal or high. Wind is the can have the value strong and weak. Water can have the value warm or cool, and the forecast can be same or change, right? So hypothesis H, each hypothesis is described by a conjunction of constraints, right? The conjunction of literals. So these conjunction of constraints on the attributes sky, air temperature, humidity, and so on, right? So these constraints may be simple question mark, which is don't care condition, right? Any value is acceptable, and or else it can be a null value. Null value is what we have shown in the previous slide, right? That is the zero and slash, you can call it. We go to the previous slide. This is the symbol for representing no value is accepted or a specific value, right? So the target concept, the target function that, or target concept C, is to enjoy the sport, which can have the value 0 or 1, boolean value. And training examples is the positive and negative examples of the target function. And ultimately, what we are going to determine is, we are going to determine a hypothesis H, which is a subset of H. H is this set, collection of hypotheses, you can say, collection of all hypotheses. So we have to determine a hypothesis H in set of hypotheses, capital H, such that the H of X is equal to C of X, right? H of X is the hypothesis and C is the target function or the target concept. And it has to be for all X in the D. D is denoted as the set of available training examples. Right, so I hope this is clear to you. So that's what we are going to do here. That is, if the target concept corresponds to the value of attribute, let's say C of X is equal to 1, if enjoy sport is yes, and if C of X is equal to 0, if enjoy sport is no. Right. So instance for which C of X is 1 is called a positive example. C of 0 is a negative example or a non-member of the target concept. And like I mentioned, D denotes the set of available training examples. H denotes the set of all possible hypotheses. And in general, each hypothesis H, small h, in capital H, which is the set of all hypotheses, represents a Boolean value. Boolean valued function defined over X. And that is represented like this. Small h, such that X is defined over a Boolean value. Now the goal of the learner is to find a hypothesis, a single hypothesis H, such that X of H is equal to C of X, right? So that's what we discussed. So having said that, let's move on to the, what is the inductive learning hypothesis. Now, although the learning task is to determine a hypothesis H, what we discussed in the previous slide, that the learning task is to determine a hypothesis H identical to the target concept C over the entire set of instances X, right? Over the entire set of instances X, now we have to see here that the only information that is available to us is the C. It is about only the C, that is the target concept or the target function, the value of C, right? The value of C over the training examples. Now, we can say that the inductive learning algorithm can be only best guarantee that the output hypothesis, whatever the output hypothesis will be, it fits the target concept, right? It fits the target concept over the training data. Now, our assumption is that the best hypothesis, let's say we are lacking of any information, and our assumption is the best hypothesis regarding, you know, unseen instances, the instances what we have not encountered, right? Regarding the unseen instances is the hypothesis that best fits the observed training data. So whatever we have observed, whatever the data that we have observed, we assume that the data, the training example will be best suitable for the unseen or unobserved instances also, right? So in a nutshell, if I want to define what is inductive learning hypothesis, so any hypothesis found to approximate the target function, right? Any hypothesis found to approximate the target function well over a sufficiently large set of training examples or large set of training data will also approximate the target function well over the other unobserved or unseen examples, right? So this is similar like you have used, let's say you have three types of bird that you have identified, and the system is made to learn those three birds, and on the basis of these three observed examples, it can predict few birds which are unobserved or unseen, right? So hypothesis, inductive learning hypothesis, is how far we are able to find an hypothesis to approximate that target function, to come up to a conclusion that those unseen birds or unobserved birds can also be termed as birds, right? And not a car. So that is all about the concept learning. If I have any doubt with respect to anything, you can simply put it into the comment section. I'll answer your doubts, or you can reach out to the WhatsApp group or our Google Classroom chat box or comment section, right? So that's all. I think I'll conclude the lecture here. So whatever we have discussed in today's lecture, I would like you to make a note of it wherever you have stuck. You can rewind the video, you can pause wherever you want to note down a few important points, and then if you still have any doubts, you can post it in the comment section or into the Google Classroom. We can address those doubts. If anybody else having the same doubt, will also be getting clarified, right? So thank you, and stay tuned for the subsequent lectures.